going to quote a verse from the Bible found in the New Testament, 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 15. This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And Paul says, of whom I am chief. This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. I want to give everybody today an opportunity just to know why what we're speaking is faithful, why it is true. We are not here to antagonize anybody. We're not here today to tell you to become religious. The reason we're here today is because we have a saying from this book, the Bible, God's Word, and it is absolutely reliable. It is absolutely truthful. You can put your trust in what we are speaking about today, friend. This is a faithful saying, worthy to be accepted by all, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Now I want to begin by talking about the reliability of the Bible. Many people that hear us preach, the one thing that they say and the one thing that they wonder is, how can you tell, how can you say that your religion is better than another? Well, first of all, I want to say that that's not what we're saying. We're not speaking about religion. We're speaking about God's Word, the Bible. And the reason this book is reliable, friend, today, and the reason you can put your faith in God's Word is because it is inspired by God. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. This book has got a number of writers, 39 different ones, and it's got a number of different books that were written over centuries. But although it's been written by different people, some were fishermen, one was a doctor, others had different jobs and different things that they did as a career in different walks of life, but every single one of them, they harmonize, and all of them point to one person, the Lord Jesus. This book prophesied of him 700 years before he came. There were over 330 prophecies regarding Christ, where he would be born. It tells us in the book of Micah, Bethlehem, Judah, though thou be little among those in Judah, yet out of thee shall come a governor who shall rule my people Israel. And then over 700 years later, Jesus fulfilled that prophecy when he was born in Bethlehem, Judah. But not only that, this book also tells us about the life that he would live. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 53 that he will grow up before God as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. Can I just say today, dear friend, there's nobody like Christ. There's no one like Jesus that lived in this world. He lived a life that was fruitful before God. He is sinless and impeccable and holy. Even other religions acknowledge that he is a great prophet. But can I tell you, he's far greater than a prophet, friend. Because God himself came into humanity, born of a virgin, so there would be no taint of sin. And he lived for 30 years, a life of perfection and holiness. And there came a moment when he began his public ministry, and even that was prophesied in the Old Testament, when it tells us that those that sat in the darkness shall see a great light. And the Lord Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He that follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. But can I say today, friend, that the Jesus we preach, he is one who has fulfilled over 333 specific prophecies that were written hundreds of years before he came. He fulfilled all of them. Let me give you a few examples. When he hung on the cross, it tells us, dear friend, that people would mock and they would curse and they would say, if thou be the Christ, come down from the cross and we'll believe thee. And it was perfectly fulfilled at the cross. Not only that, it tells us, dear friend, that the Lord Jesus, when they would come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him. And that was a fulfillment of Psalm 22 that was written 750 years before he came. And the Bible said, thoughts have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and feet. Can I tell you the significance of that, friend? The significance is this. Crucifixion. David was never crucified. He said 750 years before Christ was born that they pierced my hands and my feet, and yet David never experienced crucifixion. But David was speaking of one who was coming, one that was prophesied that he would give his hands to those that would pierce and would put nails through his hands and feet. But not only that, in the Old Testament, there's a verse that says, the smiters smited upon my back, they made long, the plowers plowed upon my back, they made long their furrows. And Jesus was taken, and he was whipped with a Roman lash until his back resembled a plowed field. He fulfilled what was written hundreds of years before. So I just want you to understand, friend, over 300 prophecies about the Lord Jesus, and every single one of them was fulfilled. This is a faithful saying, friend, worthy of all acceptation. It doesn't matter what religion you are. It doesn't matter what color your skin is. It doesn't matter, my friend, what your creed is or what your class is. God loves you, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish but have everlasting life. But the verse says this, this is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. You see, friend, when Christ came, and he began his public ministry, he said, I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Because my friend, he knew the need that you have today. He understands your heart. He knows you have sin in your heart. He knows you have sin in your life by which your conscience has been violated, and you have a burden of sin. And the Lord Jesus knows all about it, but he loves you, and he came, friend, that he might pay the debt of sin that you owe God. You see, friend, the Bible tells us that sinners are heaping up wrath against the day of wrath and the righteous revelation of the judgment of God. It's like, my friend, we are putting in a bank a deposit, and my friend, we are indebting ourselves. We owe God. And we cannot pay. We have nothing to pay. We're just sinners. But God loves us. And God has provided a way whereby the debt that we owe him can be paid. Listen to the verse today. This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Is there somebody on the street today, and you're willing to admit before God, you don't need to tell me. We don't tell you, my friend, to confess your sins to a priest. A priest cannot do a thing to remove your sin. Listen to what the Bible says. Every priest daily ministers and offers oftentimes the same sacrifices that can never take away sin. But this man, Christ, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, he sat down at the right hand of God. There's a Savior, friend, who paid the debt of sin, that you might be forgiven. You're in debt to God. In fact, worse than that, we are bankrupt because of sin, and nothing we can do can appease God or can make a payment for the debt we owe. But can I tell you that Jesus, 2,000 years ago, he willingly suffered. He hung at the cross of Calvary, and God Almighty from heaven, he poured out upon him his judgment for sin, friend. You say, whose sin? Let me answer from the Bible. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures and was buried, and he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. You see, friend, you and I, one day, we must meet God. I know a man from history. Look up his name. His name is Daniel Webster. He was considered a genius. Daniel Webster helped make part of the border that leads from Canada to the United States. And he was a tremendous man of intellect. Daniel Webster said the most awe-inspiring thought that came into my mind. He said the most intelligent thought that I have ever had that came into my mind was this: I must meet God. Listen to what he says. I must meet God. See, friend, we're going to meet God. And we're either going to meet God in our sins and we'll perish forever, or we will meet God in Christ and be in heaven. Now, the Lord Jesus has made a payment for sin. And you, my friend, today can be forgiven because Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again. That's proof that he has paid the debt of sin. For when Jesus finished suffering at the cross, he bowed his head and dismissed his spirit, and he was laid in a borrowed tomb. And on the third day, he rose again. And my friend, that is evidence that your sins can be forgiven, because God raised him from the dead, and he is ascended at the right hand of God. And the gospel we preach today is this, that this is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And Paul says, of whom I am chief. He made it personal, friend. If you want to come into the good of God's salvation, you need to take it for yourself. Listen to the verse again. This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Look at the chart, friend. You can be taken from that broad road that leads to destruction and leads to hell in the lake of fire, and you can enter onto that narrow gate that leads up to heaven if you'll simply receive the Lord Jesus as your Savior. Because this is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Is there somebody here today, and you'd be willing to say, I'm chief of sinners, I've sinned against God, but if Christ came to save sinners, I'll trust him today, and I'll receive him as my Savior. My friend, if you're willing to do that, God will forgive every sin, and you'll be made right with God, and you'll have a home in heaven. Would you receive Christ today? This is a faithful saying, worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And we pray today someone might say from the heart, of whom I am chief. And you might trust Christ and know the blessedness of peace with God and the forgiveness of sins.